Welcome back to Jeff Diamond's Vikings and NFL Insider. Yes, we have the schedule. We'll find out what Jeff, former Vikings general manager, thinks about the schedule. We'll also talk about what else the Vikings have to accomplish this summer. We'll talk about the Vikings' history of international games. Now they're going to be playing Aaron Rodgers and the Jets in London. They've had very good experiences overseas for the most part. And we'll talk about just what Jeff expects for a fairly young team going to what looks to me like a difficult schedule. This show is part of TalkNorth.com. Please subscribe to your favorite podcast app. It's the easiest way to listen. It's also free. Check out the rest of our shows, including the Viking Update Show, John Krasinski on the Timberwolves, Mike Grimm on the Gophers, Chin Music, Roy Smalley, Lavelle Neal, and myself. We've got about 20 shows, including outdoor shows, variety shows. Check them all out. Subscribe to the shows you like. We're coming to you from the Aquarius Home Services Studios. We want to thank our longtime sponsor, White Bear Lake Superstore, whitebearlakesuperstore.com. Also check out my friend's shop, Scott Dayton, Twill by Scott Dayton in the Dyna Galleria. All right, Jeff, your first impression of this schedule.
Well, the first thing I always say about schedules, and I always refer back to Bud Grant, our Hall of Fame coach, who would always say, it's not who you play, but when you play them. And I think that there's a lot of truth in that statement, obviously, depending on the health of your team, the health of the opponent at the time you face them. Are you on a roll? Are they on a roll or not? And so I think those all play into it, because you look at this at schedules when they first come out, and you automatically look at the Vikings schedule and you say, whoa, that those three of the first 4 weeks, they've got playoff teams, and San Francisco and Houston are here. Then they're at Green Bay. They face the Jets in London, which is not going to be an easy game. But then they have an early bye, which I don't think is advantageous to have a bye in week six necessarily, compared to maybe more midseason week eight or nine. But after an international trip, it's a good thing. And they come right back and face two more playoff teams, the Lions here and at the Rams, on a short week on a Thursday night with the travel to the West Coast. So it's definitely not an easy start to the season. I think the Giants will be a better team this year in the opener. And Daniel Jones returns, but he doesn't have Saquon Barkley. He does have a lot of other very good players on that team, including Malik Nabers now, the great wide receiver out of LSU in the first round. So the Giants will be a test, but then it gets really tough. And the other thing I don't like about the Vikings schedule, I never wanted to have three in a row on the road, which they have November 10th, 17th, and 24th at Jacksonville, at Tennessee, at Chicago. That's a tough stretch when you're on the road so many weeks, but then they come right back with three in a row at home, which is a weird scheduling when they face Arizona, Atlanta, and Chicago, which are three games that could be considered winnable at that stage before they finish with another tough stretch at Seattle, which is always a tough game, and then Packers here and at Detroit. So it's certainly a formidable schedule, I think. But again, it just depends, as I said, as Bud said, not who you play, but when you play them. And so we'll see how it all shakes out. But I think it was always, in my view, kind of a milestone of the season upcoming when the schedule was released, because you've finished free agency for the most part. The draft is over. The offseason program's in full swing. Rookie camp was last weekend. Mini camp's coming up. OTA's coming up starting on next Monday. But the schedule, to me, Jim, always was kind of the true signal that the upcoming season was fast approaching. And so I always paid close attention to the schedule, and especially the spacing of home and away games. Obviously preferring never to have three in a row on the road, which the Vikings have this year. The bye week, a great interest. They don't have a great bye week in terms of scheduling, except it's after the London game. And then looking at what potential cold weather games the team would have, and you look at the schedule, and realistically, there's not any. I guess the only one you would say could be is playing at Chicago November 24th. But other than that, there are no cold weather games on the schedule, which I think is a definite advantage for an indoor team like the Vikings now, compared to it used to be a big advantage for us back in the day.
Yes, no doubt about it. When Jeff, you know, I've been covering the NFL since 89. I was a fan as early as the 60s. You worked your way up through the organization, you know, way back in the days of the Purple People Eaters. When do you remember the schedule being released being an extravaganza instead of just a press release?
Yeah, certainly not early in my career. It never was. And even back in my Titan years in the early 2000s, it was not that big. It was certainly not a network show, shall we say. It was you would get a call from the league office on the afternoon the schedule was coming out, and you would complain about certain games, which didn't matter to them. but you had to vent a little bit. But it was not considered, as you said, the big extravaganza it is today, and how they play it up and so forth. But yeah, I think it certainly has changed. And I think part of that is the onset of these international games, which get a lot more kind of advanced publicity on them, of which the Vikings have the game against the Jets on October 6th in London. That'll be an exciting trip for the organization, exciting game. And I would say somewhat fortunate in my career that we had four international games, but they were all preseason games back in those days. And we played in London. We had actually the first game in London, which might have been the first international game, which was quite an experience with a promoter that we thought was kind of a crooked guy, and it was a mess and a lot of things to untangle. And we played in Tokyo against Joe Montana, when he was with the Chiefs. We played in Berlin, and we played in Gothenburg, Sweden, which was probably my favorite trip in terms of an international experience. But it was a very difficult trip for me because I was the team travel coordinator at the time. Ooh. Early in my career as director of team operations. And that was extremely challenging trip. And in fact, we went over in April after the game was announced, just to advance the game, or in early May. And I went over, we were playing the Bears. I went over with Scott Studwell, and the Bears went over Bill McGrain, the longtime Bears operations man. And Dan Hampton went, and that was quite an experience back in the day, and with jet lag, and Hampton maybe had a few too many cocktails the night before a press conference.
I was wondering if you'd say something like that.
And he actually fell asleep on the table at the luncheon, and so we had to kind of give him a kick, like, "Hey, Dan, wake up!" But between jet lag and a couple cocktails, but that was quite the experience. And the Sweden game was fun, and I remember spending time with Mike Ditka in downtown Gothenburg. He was sitting outside at some restaurant, and he was a character, as we all know. But those were really interesting experiences. I would say I enjoyed it more once I was no longer in charge of team travel, which I think was the case when we went to Berlin. and by then, the NFL had gotten more involved, because early on, they did not. And they sent over one operations guy to help us put it together. We went to London, but it was, wow, it was really a very challenging situation. So I think today, things are much more established, streamlined on those international trips. But it still does kind of mess with your schedule. Coaches, I don't think, are thrilled with international games, because they have to take the team over early. You got to practice. And it's obviously, as I said, a big challenge for the team operations people when you're dealing with different cultures, perhaps different languages. Not in London, but when the Eagles and Packers play in week two in Sao Paulo, Brazil, believe me, that's going to be a challenge for those teams and their operations departments, dealing with the first game in Brazil or in South America, or whatever you want to talk about. It's just going to be, that's going to be a crazy experience for them too.
Well, I covered an Olympics in Brazil, and I mean, beautiful city. I mean, beautiful city, beautiful country, but I don't think they really knew what they're doing in terms of operating the Olympics. A lot of things felt really thrown together. It'll be interesting to see if they're ready for an NFL game.
Yeah, I think that, what wasn't that the one where they went into billions of dollars in debt or something?
Most Olympics do lose money, but I think they lost a lot of money.
Yeah, exactly. And I don't know if you were in Rio or in Sao Paulo.
I was in Rio.
But it certainly seems like a very exciting, energetic country and city.
Oh yeah, I really enjoyed the trip, but you didn't want to turn down the wrong street.
No, I'm sure that was the case.
Yeah,
I think that's one of the concerns on an international trip when the players have all this extra time, and you want to make sure they're obviously staying out of trouble and staying in the right places. London, they don't have the language barrier; they can probably get back to the hotel pretty easily, but some of these other places, yeah, I would be concerned about that. And I was concerned.
Tell me, I had forgotten about, I knew about the Sweden game. I knew about the Berlin. I knew about, obviously, we've known about the history of games in London. I had forgotten about the Tokyo game. Tell me more about that one.
Yeah, that was really a very interesting experience, I thought. And as I said, by then the league was more involved. And so it was less on my shoulders. And by that point, I was actually the GM of the team, so I wasn't coordinating team travel as I had in London and Sweden. And the Tokyo game, I thought was a really interesting experience. Staying in Tokyo, just a crazy, hectic, crowded city. But we took a side trip, my wife and I, to one of the ancient cities with a fantastic garden, Kyoto, I think it was, with these ancient gardens, and it was really a very fun day and getting away from kind of the hotel for the day. But I remember our security director called me that night and said, "Where have you been all day? We've been worried about you." And I thought, hey, you don't have to worry about me. You need to worry about our players.
Yeah, no doubt about it. All right, I want to talk more about the Giants game. Might tell some other Tokyo stories here. We're talking about what the Vikings have left on their agenda for this summer. But right now, let's hear more about White Bear Lake Superstore, whitebearlakesuperstore.com.
Thanks, Jim. The White Bear Lake Superstore, Buick GMC, with my great friend, owner Paul Rubin, general manager Charlie Gattrell, their fantastic staff, Minnesota's number one volume Buick GMC dealer, 6 years running, with the best selection and their super friendly premium team. Check out their great website, whitebearlakesuperstore.com. You will see the first ever Invista. It defies the most characterizations, $25,880 on that great vehicle. The GMC Hummer EV pickup and SUV is the world's first all-electric super truck. You'll also see 1.9% APR and a $3,250 purchase allowance on 2024 GMC Sierra 1500s, 0.9% APR, and a $750 purchase allowance on 2024 Buick Encore GX, with no monthly payments for 90 days on these great vehicles. The White Bear Lake Superstore is the Quigley 4x4 van superstore. They are a certified elite dealer. Only 7% of GM dealers make the cut. Visit in person at 3900 Highway 61 North in White Bear Lake or online at whitebearlakesuperstore.com for all your vehicle needs and the premium experience. Buick GMC, we are professional grade.
We're coming to you from the Aquarius Home Services Studios. Check out Aquarius Home Services. Also check out Twill and the Dina Galleria, just great men's clothing store. Best in Minnesota, with my friend Scott Dayton. Tell him we sent you. So looking, you always reference the Bud Grant line, when you play them. I have a corollary to that, which is you can look at the schedule and say, okay, good, they're opening against the Giants, who really struggled last year. I always feel like you don't want to play bad teams until they know they're bad. Opening day, they still think they're good.
I think you're right. And that's a great point. And as I said, they'll get Daniel Jones back. They added Malik Nabers. They had the big pass rusher from Jacksonville in the trade. And so you're talking about a team that they've got plenty of talent. They were in the, obviously, in the playoffs the year before 2022, and beat the Vikings here in the wild card game. And so we know that they're a talented team. They don't have Saquon Barkley anymore, which is, I think, a significant loss for them. But yeah, I think you're right that in the opening game, anything can happen. And I remember a couple of years ago, the Vikings went to Cincinnati and everybody thought, oh, this is going to be an easy game. Well, that was, I think, Joe Burrow, whatever, his second season or whatever. And the Vikings lose a game that they had a chance to win. There was a late fumble by Dalvin Cook. And then they go down to Arizona that year, got beat by Kyler Murray, and all of a sudden you're off to an 0-2 start. And especially when you're looking at week two and facing San Francisco here, who they did beat here last year, but that was perhaps Kirk Cousins' best game as a Viking in his 6 years to get that win, and with Jefferson out and Addison had a big game. So the 49ers, maybe it's an advantage to play them early compared to playing them late, and I believe they're coming off a Monday night game in the opener. The 49ers, I believe they play the Jets in the Monday night opener. So they'll be traveling on a short week. So these are some of the nuances of the schedule that you think about. But I also think some of those things are overrated about short weeks and this and that, except for Thursday nights. Those are definitely tough. And playing on the road, playing at the Rams, that's going to be a challenge. And remember a couple of years ago, I think the Vikings played at the Rams on a Thursday night, and Jared Goff threw for about 400 yards or something. They scored about 50 points on that Vikings defense. So, and that might have been their Super Bowl season.
That was their Super Bowl season, and Goff was great. Cooper Kupp was still a little bit unknown. I think they got him matched up on Anthony Barr on a crossing route. It went for about 60 yards and a touchdown.
Yes, I remember that.
And Mike Zimmer hated nothing more than losing to a young whiz kid offensive coordinator like Sean McVay.
Yeah, you're exactly right. And it was kind of funny this morning to read your colleague Mark Craig's column about games to look forward to this season. He was talking about Kirk Cousins facing Mike Zimmer when Atlanta plays Dallas. And
yes.
That they can renew acquaintances after their, shall we say, somewhat tumultuous time together.
Well, I'll tell a story. The Vikings were playing the Lions here when Lions were getting better, but we still thought they were a bad team and a bad franchise. And the Vikings had gotten off to a slow start. I can't remember which year it was, but it was, pretty well into the relationship. And I wrote a piece saying, hey, and the Vikings were in bad shape at that point. I wrote a piece saying, hey, if the Vikings lose to the Lions team today, then everybody might get fired. From what I'm told, the team PR people did not, they made sure that clip was not included in the morning package of clips that went to players and coaches. They made sure that Zimmer didn't know that. That was the game that Cousins leads the last second comeback to win the game. And then it looked like Zimmer was ready to punch him on the sideline when they got the game winning field goal.
Right.
What Cousins was saying was Cousins had read what I wrote. Cousins turned to Zimmer and said, I just saved your job. And Zimmer looked like he wanted to haul off and hit him. And then he realized, hold on, I'm on the sideline and we just won the game. I can't punch my quarterback.
That's a great unknown story from that whole thing.
They did not like each other, and I think it's one of the reasons Cousins kind of came out of his shell after Zimmer left, and Cousins all of a sudden seemed like to be a much more fun-loving guy.
Yeah, I think that's definitely true, and he certainly had a much better rapport with Kevin O'Connell. We know that, and now he's taking it down to Atlanta. We'll see how that shakes out. I do see that the Falcons seem to have a fair number of national TV appearances this year, so maybe they're thinking that he will help lead them back to prosperity. We'll see about that. For the Vikings, not so much on the national TV stage this year. I guess the London game would be considered one, and obviously the Rams on the Thursday night. They play the Bears on a Monday night, but really there are not very many national TV games, which tells us that the league office thinks that the Vikings will be chasing certainly the Lions and Packers in the NFC North. But as we know, things can change in a hurry, as it did 2 years ago when the Vikings won 13 games. So you never know how it's all going to play out.
Do you like schedules where division games are stacked at the end as they are this year?
Yeah, I think that's good for the league. I think it's good for competition, for division titles to be decided. The league wants to have those kind of games at the end of the year as they kind of have the flex scheduling late in the season, so they can maybe put the Vikings at the Lions if that's the game for the NFC North title, which the Vikings would love to be in that position if they can get there. And so, yeah, I think that's a good thing for the league and for the teams too, because then you're playing your prime competition at the end of the year. It's just going to need to turn out better than it did last year late in the season when the Packers drilled the Vikings in that second to last game here. Jordan Love was on his roll at the time, and then they went to Detroit, and the Vikings were already out of it, and the Lions won that game. And so I think it's going to be a good finish, and actually three of the last four within the division. And the Bears are another team to watch out for this year. And we always look at teams and look at seasons and who could be the worst to first teams. And certainly the Bears are in the conversation this year with the additions that they've made. But a lot of that's going to depend on Caleb Williams and how he comes out. And I thought it was interesting already, Jim, when the Bears coach Matt Eberflus, the Bears had their rookie camp last weekend, as the Vikings did. And all these coaches talking up their first-round quarterbacks, other than Gerard Mayo in New England, who said of Drake May, he's got a lot of work to do. So he was the realistic guy. All the other ones are talking, oh, wow, these guys look great, and blah, blah, blah. As we know, it's very early to make that kind of proclamation based on a two- or three-day rookie camp. We'll know more about these guys like J.J. McCarthy here when the vets come in next week, and then even more in training camp when they have full padded practices and they maybe have another team coming in for a couple of days and they have preseason games, which I expect we'll see a lot of McCarthy and Sam Darnold this year, which will make the preseason games a little more interesting. But the true test, of course, will be, when does J.J. McCarthy play in regular season? And that's going to be the big question throughout the offseason, throughout training camp, of course. But Caleb Williams, getting back to him, and Eberflus, after, I guess, was the first day of the rookie camp, goes, no conversation, he's the starter, which I thought was kind of interesting. Obviously, we know he's going to be the starter. He's the number one pick in the draft. But how about just pretending there's a competition? because Williams is already entitled, and all you do is you're just playing into it even more.
Of course, the fact that he's entitled might have led them to want to just clear the air so he's not pouting.
And that could be the case. I'm just, as we've talked before, I'm not sold on him yet. I got to see it. And, I mean, really, with all these guys, because we know six first-round quarterbacks, probably half of them are going to be either busts or be traded or whatever, as was the case with that 2021 draft where there were five first-rounders. And the only one left with his current team is Trevor Lawrence. So Trey Lance is gone, although perhaps he could be the Cowboys starter in 2025 if Dak Prescott doesn't get extended. So there are a lot of moving parts going on around the league right now, and a lot of it involves these six rookie quarterbacks. Sean Payton, who is always annoying.
Always.
But I thought it was funny. He said, yeah, it's like watching a really good golfer, watching Bo Nix play. Okay. If that's what you think, fine.
Yeah. Well, and I said this on the Viking Update show with John Krasinski when we were talking about this. You know, Sean Payton, he won one Super Bowl. He had Drew Brees, and he took a lot of credit for developing Drew Brees, who had already been a good NFL quarterback in San Diego before his injury. If Sean Payton drafted the wrong quarterback or doesn't develop Bo Nix, we're going to look at him a lot differently than we did when he was in his heyday.
Yeah, and that's definitely true. And certainly his first season was very up and down in Denver, unfortunately for the Vikings. That was one of their key losses in that game. But they did have quarterback issues. We'll see if Bo Nix can be the guy that can get it done for them. He is a guy that had more experience than some of these other quarterbacks, such as McCarthy, having played a lot in college at Oregon and previously. So, yeah, this is a big test for Sean Payton, but it's really a test for Kevin O'Connell, too, in the development of J.J. McCarthy, in that this is the guy that they had identified, that they wanted, even if Drake May was their main choice, but they could never get a shot at him. But now I think the pressure is on O'Connell, maybe not so much on Kwesi Adolfo Menza, the GM, because he got him here and also got Dallas Turner here, the edge rusher, and that'll be interesting to watch his development too. I think both those guys need to be bulked up in this offseason program so they can kind of handle the physicality of the NFL. But yeah, I think the pressure is squarely on O'Connell right now with McCarthy.
No doubt. Good stuff from Jeff. We'll talk more about all of this going forward. We'll also talk about what other roster moves the Vikings could make. There's still some good corners on the market. And we'll talk more about when McCarthy should play. As you know, the NFL will always provide us with lots to talk about. So thanks for listening to Jeff Diamond's Vikings and NFL Insider. Subscribe to your favorite podcast app to this or any show you like at TalkNorth.com. And we'll talk to you next week.